टुडे
ठीक
आई एम वेरी मच प्रिविलेज्ड, वी गॉट डॉक्टर मनोरमा, चीफ साइंटिस्ट इन नैनो मटेरियल्स लेबोरेटरी, CSIR, IICT, दैट इज इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ केमिकल टेक्नोलॉजी हैदराबाद, एज अ डिस्टिंग्विश्ड स्पीकर. वेल, लेट मी टेल अ ब्रीफ अबाउट मैडम्स रिसर्च. डॉक्टर मनोरमा'स रिसर्च इंटरेस्ट कैन बी ब्रॉडली क्लासिफाइड into material science. This includes design and development of materials, especially nanostructured materials, for the application in sensors, catalysis, including photocatalysis, photovoltaic devices like dye sensitized solar cell, etc., fabrication of prototype devices, and studying the performance characteristics. With her expertise in materials design and synthesis, Dr. Manorama has been successful in developing surface functionalized nanostructured magnetically recoverable catalysts for hydrogenation and several known reactions. By controlling the synthesis route, surface engineering of oxide materials by tailoring the phase and morphology was achieved to obtain efficient visible light active photocatalytic materials for the degradation of organic pollutants. To tell about a brief about her qualification, academic qualification, Dr. Manorama has completed her BSc from Pune University and MSc MPhil in physics from Pune University, Pune, and a PhD also from Pune University. Okay, madam is a life member of MRSI, Indian Ceramic Society, Indian Crystallographic Society, Indian Women Scientists Association. She is a visiting faculty at School of Engineering, Akita University, Akita Prefecture in Japan. Okay, let me go through the long list of honors and awards. Selected a few, I'm just going through it. Commonwealth Fellowship for Physics by the Association of Commonwealth Universities, UK, in 1989-90. She's a winner of the R&D Award for the best research work on gas sensors and their applications by the NSPTS 96, CSIR Foundation Day, IICT Best Women Scientist Award 2005 and 2008, JSPS Short Term Invitation Fellowship in 2002, Australian Leadership Award, ALA 2009 Fellow, Flinders University, Adelaide, Australia, Fellow of Andhra Pradesh Academy of Sciences in 2010, Co-Chair of MCARE 2012 in Florida, US, ACS Membership Award 2015, and Sita Mahalakshmi Endowment Lecture of the TAS 2016, nominated and winner of the Professor Rudolph A. Marcus Award 2016 by publishing Division of Cognizio and Lognor. Okay, so it's a very long list. And among the top 2% global researchers in materials in the Stanford University Study 2020. So now we can all understand after I go through this amazing list, and ma'am is among the top 2% global researchers. That survey has been done in 2020 by Stanford University. So we are really, really privileged. Our faculty, students, all the attendees, PhD scholars, we are very much privileged to have such a distinguished speaker among us. Academic highlights, Dr. Manorama has supervised students, 12 PhDs in chemistry and 2 PhDs in physics. Course coordinator, she's a course coordinator of ACSIR Advanced Functional Materials. As I've already told, the research interest mainly of nanostructured materials design and development for the application in sensor catalysis, including photocatalysis, photovoltaic devices, just like dye sensitized solar cell, fabrication of prototype devices and studying the performance characteristics. Madam has published 129 publications in peer-reviewed journals, 4 patents, 4 book chapters, 2 popular science articles, 1 review article, and more than 90 invited lectures and plenary talks. With this short introduction, let me welcome today's speaker, Dr. Manorama. Madam, please.
Thank you very much, Sudeshna. That was not a short introduction. It was quite long. Okay. Good afternoon to all the participants. And first of all, thank you very much for giving this opportunity to talk to you. I appreciate Sudeshna's persistence to get me on to talk here. It was like our acquaintance, as she already mentioned, is like several years back, but she's maintained that contact and not left me to deliver this talk today. I appreciate it. Thank you very much for that. Okay, first, before I begin, I'll just share my presentation. So I'll stop my video and share my presentation. Is it okay?
Yeah.
My voice is clear, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Yeah. Madam, can you speak little louder?
Actually, I can increase the volume. I thought it was too loud, so that's why I reduced the volume. Okay.
No, voice is little, yeah.
1 minute, I know I have to do something. Arun, where was this thing? Oh, no, yes, 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 yes. Oh, yes, okay. I can increase the volume.
Yeah, yeah, please.
Go ahead. Is it better?
Wait. Some more loud, you can make it.
Now?
Yeah, Jyoti madam, I think now it's fine, right?
Are you able to hear me?
Little yes, more would be better, ma'am. Little more will be better.
Now?
In the maximum level?
It's the maximum level.
Okay, that's fine. Then please keep it there only.
Wait a minute. There are two. Arun, I have to increase that volume. This lower one. This one. Now is it more?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Now it is perfectly okay.
Okay. Because there are two things here. Output level, input level. I think I was raising the wrong one.
Jyoti, okay. Madam,
now can you hear me?
Yeah, I'm in perfect level.
Okay, fine. Fine, now I share the slides presentation. Are you able to see? Is it full screen or not?
No, not full screen.
Okay, 1 minute. Now?
Yeah, now I think in the slide show mode you have to. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Now it's in
okay.
Slide show mode.
Now it's okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Good afternoon to all. And the next, maybe I think 40 minutes. I will just kind of introduce the topic, and I won't go to my work because that will be another lecture. Just wanted to impress on you what we are doing in material science and why these sized materials are so important. Okay, thank you very much for your patient hearing. So the title I have given as it is Designing Materials for Future Applications, Nanotechnology. And how this particular branch of science has opened up so many new opportunities. Now, the whole science as it goes is all basically on size. Okay. Now, as you must be all aware, and this you must have heard several times, materials are basically the milestones of progress. Like you've seen over the ages, how societies have developed and how each age has been defined by the material. Okay, so you had what is called as the Stone Age, the Bronze Age, and so on. And through time and ages of civilizations, these materials, we have different metals have been used. And now we are currently in the age of design materials or designer materials. What do you mean by designer materials? You can design the materials up to the way you want it. How do you do that? And can you really do it, or is it just simply science fiction is the question. So the materials of the future are already a reality. Basically, when you say designer materials, you're talking about intelligent materials, property changing materials, energy exchanging materials, functional materials, nanomaterials, which is of course a subset of the designer materials, and biochemically active materials, and most, this is an exhaustive list, and I've just put a few of them here. So I would like to make my presentation in the following way. What is material science by itself? I mean, what does this subject encompass? What is the perspective of material science? Why do you really need to do material science? Then what is material science and engineering? Then what are the properties of solid materials which you try to invoke? What is this very important structure property correlation? Then you have what is called as processing and performance, and an interplay between all this, which actually helps you to design the materials. Okay, so you have the early humans, they had natural materials, and that was a very, very limited, their applications were very, very limited. So they had the stone or the iron or the wood or whatever, anything is material. They could even, at the most, they could cut it or chisel it or sharpen it or shape it the way they wanted to. But inventions are, but the properties of the materials remain changed till then. But actually the invention is in trying to alter these properties for the requirement. So currently scientists, they can understand the relationship between structure of the materials and their properties. They're able to do this. And that is what has opened up a total new area of research, where you can actually have the final material in your mind and then design the material right from the atomic scale. So development of technologies, basically, why do you develop these technologies? Because whatever research a person does in whatever field of research that you are into, what is the final aim? You're trying to make your life comfortable. So you're talking about getting more efficient cars, you want more efficient lighting, you want more efficient cooling, you want good high speed and so on, good food, better tasty food, long lasting foods, then clothing which are more comfortable and they're more convenient. So basically you are trying to make your life comfortable, and in the process to achieve that, you are trying to come out with materials which would actually answer all your questions or solve all your problems. That's the main game. So that's why I said development of technologies is actually because you're looking for a comfortable life. And this is the forerunner to the progress of mankind. So we are going forward with high speed internet, or say faster moving cars and so on. All this because you are able to make better performing materials. So, and there's no limit to that. If you get some value of X in a property, you tend to get like X plus delta or 2X or 10X or 100X. That's what is driving us and allowing us to move forward. Okay, so basically material science is, in the basic definition, is investigating relation between structure and properties of materials. And then this further, when you go down, now along with material science, you really need to do the engineering, because it's not just trying to do basic research and living at that. Putting them into real materials and making it applicable to mankind, you really need to engineer it. So on the basis of these structure property correlation, designing or engineering the structure of a material to obtain the desired properties. Then you have upscaling, and then finally getting the product out. So all that is material science and engineering. So nowadays, the departments are not just Department of Material Science. It will always be material science and engineering. Okay. So first of all, what is structure? Structure is basically arrangement of internal components. It could be subatomic, microscopic. First subatomic, then it will become microscopic, then macroscopic, and so on. And what's the property? It is a material trait, kind of and the magnitude of response to a specific imposed stimulus. So along with structure and property, you need to understand what is processing and performance. So basically, material science is all about structure, property, processing, and performance. So this is kind of a tetrahedron. So where you have all of them interrelated. Suppose you make a material, then as a synthesis process, what is the process of synthesis? Then you understand the properties, like what are the basic characteristics it exhibits. Then you do the structure characterization. Then depending on the structure and characterization, are you happy with its performance? If not, go back again, synthesize a better material, and this goes on and on. Now, along with this synthesis and processing, properties and characterization, modeling also has become very, very important. So basically, you have the four parts of the tetrahedron: synthesis and processing. You're developing new materials and modifying materials after you're or doing the manufacture, structure and characterization, whatever it is. So each one. Now, in this process, synthesis and processing, you're trying to either make new materials or you're trying to improve the properties of existing materials. Then in the structure and characterization, we are trying to study this, studying the matter in which manner in which the atoms are arranged. So I'm using different instruments, all the characterization facilities that are now available, try to use that and try to understand the structure and and characterize those materials. Then, of course, how these materials behave or interact with the environment, such as how they conduct heat and how what is the strength and so on. Those are the properties. Finally, coming to modeling and simulation. Now, this is one area which has gained a lot of importance over the last 2 to 3 decades. And it has become very important primarily because by involving or by invoking the principles of modeling and simulation, we can make the other 3 steps much easier. Because suppose earlier what we used to do, we used to make the material, then we used to characterize, then we used to study the properties, and then if we are not happy with the properties, go back again, synthesize a new material. And so all this takes a lot of time. But if you could do a little bit of modeling or simulation, you could actually predict what could be the structure, what could be the property, and what could be the device that you can expect from these materials. So this modeling and simulation has added an extra branch to the R&D for material science, and it has made life much easier, much more convenient. So we need the participation of all these 4 groups of scientists in trying to develop a new material or trying to develop a material with better properties. Going further, I just wanted to give you a simple example, which you all must have seen it, but I just wanted to show you how just the structure, the microstructure of a material influences one simple property. Again, I took the example of alumina. Okay. The pictures that I've shown here on the right hand side is basically alumina, all 3 are alumina, Al2O3. But you see, the lower bottommost one is transparent, totally transparent. The middle picture, you have alumina, which is slightly translucent. And the top one is also alumina, but it is opaque. Now, what is it that is actually giving this kind of different properties? All of them have the same constituent, Al2O3. Then what is it that's making it? Okay, as you can see here, this bottom one is simply a single crystal of sapphire, okay, 100% pure. The second one is a polycrystalline material, okay, which makes it slightly translucent. And the last one is a polycrystalline material that contains with 5% of porosity. So it's not totally very tightly packed, and so it is opaque. So this transparency, translucency, and opaqueness is simply because of the interaction of light with that matter. So basically, you could actually use light as a very important source in trying to characterize your materials. This is just one example, just to show you how the structure, how the atoms are arranged, the same atoms are arranged in 3 different kinds of materials, gives you 3 different properties. Okay, so from white to transparent. So basically what you're trying to do, you're trying to do the absorption studies. Okay, and the first example that comes to mind for anybody when they talk about trying to understand how these size makes a major role in the property is people talk about the sunscreen. Okay, in maybe about 10 to 15 years back, when people use the sunscreen, you remember very well, they used to cover it on the face, put it on the face, and you could see the white powderish kind of a material on the face. But now currently used sunscreens are transparent. How did a white opaque powder become transparent? It's simply because the particle size of the constituent materials was changed. So here you can see, if you see the UV absorption spectrum of the ones which are having, say, 200 nanometer kind of nanoparticles, and then you go down to smaller size, the 100 nanometers, you can say that in the visible region, the absorption scattering has come down, has increased, absorption has decreased. And that is what makes the sunscreens transparent to visible radiation, and that's why cosmetically it's much more favorable, or it is earning a lot of money. It's a very good money earner, for especially for the cosmetic industry. And what are you trying to do here? You're simply correlating the size of the particles with the absorption properties. And finally, that absorption has a major role to play in the appearance. So properties are thus a manifestation of the atoms, molecules, their arrangement, size, shape, etc. And what are the implications? Implications are, if we can control the arrangement, we can realize materials exhibiting the desired properties. Suppose you are interested in a material which is like, say, highly conducting, or you are interested in a material which exhibits, say, antibacterial property, or you're trying to look for a highly insulating material or scratch resistant materials. So once you know your property that you're looking for, you can actually design the materials. Basically, you can control the arrangements of the atoms to realize the materials with the desired properties. And that is the basis of nanotechnology. The next two slides are just a reminder that these numbers, which we tend to read but tend to forget very often. So I thought, just to renew your memories, I thought these are numbers we should know very well, especially in the area of nanotechnology, because all the sizes, all the particle sizes all become comparable to nanoscale. And so you have Avogadro's number, charge of electron, all these become very important. So I just put down these numbers because this I had used it when I was teaching the PhD students. So very often people say, what is a nanomaterial? They say it's a small size. What do you mean by small? Small is not a definition, at least not a scientific definition. You have to precisely say what is that size, because that size is what determines all the properties and all the advantages that you get from nanotechnology is simply because the particles are in the range of nanometers. Okay. So you're defining a whole science and technology just based on the science, on the size. So nanoscience is just by definition 0.1 nanometers to 100 nanometers. Study of matter of that range is called nanoscience. An application of this knowledge to make useful materials, structures, and devices is nanotechnology. Of course, one of the major requirements in nanotechnology, especially nanotechnology, is in trying to make equipment or systems or instruments wherein you can study these nanomaterials. Okay, so that itself is a big major thrust area of research, not in just synthesizing, but trying to develop better and better equipment, trying to understand the size at nano and maybe still smaller size if it's possible. So you talk about a TEM or a AFM or an SEM and so on. So nanotechnology also involves in making instruments wherein those sizes can be easily studied. So just as a kind of a beginning, just to know, tell you where we are. So you know where is the football, the soccer ball is about 22 centimeters. And right down, you come down to the C60, the carbon fullerene. So it's about 0.7 nanometers. So the shape is the same, but the size has gone down right from centimeters to nanometers. Then you have all the intermediate sizes and you know where they all lie in between. But most interesting thing is why actually this particular size become so important. For a long time, we were on the macro side. You're talking about centimeters. We went down to millimeters, then a little bit onto microns. But suddenly nanotechnology has that scale, that range of scale of material, suddenly opened up a total new field. So why could that reason suddenly so much of focus on that? I think I wouldn't answer that question. You can ask it yourself, simply because the classical laws of physics fail below the nano size. You have to invoke the quantum mechanics or quantum physics, then only you can understand the nanoparticles. So because of this difference, you have a lot of new properties which are coming up, which were not exhibited by the micron size or the macro size particles. Okay, I continue. Now, what do you mean by property change? Just by going from, say, centimeter or millimeter to nanoscale, can I have lots of examples. One example where the size actually opens up a very good property is gold. Gold is known to be a noble material. Okay. What do you mean by noble material? In our school times, we were told gold, silver, platinum are all noble metals. What do you mean by noble metals? The definition we were told was it reacts or does not react very well with the popular or the common chemicals or acids and alkalis. But the nano-sized gold, if you would like to know what is the kind of nobleness that gold exhibits, especially when it goes down to the nano size, nano gold powder can actually catch fire. If you make gold nanoparticles about 1 nanometer size particles and put them in a petri dish, when they expose it to air, it catches fire. Okay, so a noble material in the macro size becomes a pyrophoric material in the nano size. Okay, so this is the range of property change that takes place when you go down the scale. Okay, now gold nanoparticles are not new, and that is a historical perspective. Gold nanoparticles is not new. Why do I say that? Because right from ancient days, people were using gold powders and silver powders in trying to make paints. They didn't use the word nano, but they called them colloids. So they knew a physical procedure. They would grind or they would crush the particles for some amount of time, and then they put them into the glasses. They got different colors. So they could get blue color, green color, yellow color. Of course, they didn't know beyond that. They just called them colloidal gold particles. Okay, this was discovered by Michael Faraday in 1857. And they also called as activated carbon gold. They use the word activated gold because they're very, very highly active. And that's the word they use now, is catalytic gold. Okay, then going to the next. And the real thrust of work, especially in the area of nanotechnology, came up when Richard Feynman gave his seminal talk in 1959, and he won the Nobel Prize for that in 1965, when he said, there's plenty of room at the bottom. Now, what is the meaning of this sentence, there's plenty of room at the bottom, in those days, 1959? 1959 was a time when there were people are talking about atom bomb, people are talking about going to the moon, people have a spacewalk and so on. So people are talking about all big things. Okay, at that time, Richard Feynman made this statement, and he said, there's plenty of room at the bottom. What he wanted to say was, don't look for only big things. There is lot of research to be done even on the smaller scale. That is what it means. There's plenty of room at the bottom. It means then plenty of scope for research even at the smaller scale. Then, of course, subsequently, you had a discovery of the tunneling microscope and so on. And then, of course, you had the discovery of the carbon nanotube, C60, Kabi Buckyball, and so on. So then research in nanotechnology was rewarded regularly. And then you had the carbon nanotube by Ijima and so on. So this is the kind of a historical perspective of nanotechnology. So this is not to leave behind Hollywood and the entertainment industry. These words of nanotechnology were there even in the film industry. Okay, you know of the Spider-Man effect, nanotechnology scientist William Dafoe and Spider-Man. So I'll come to IIM because there's no this kind of a webinar. I can't actually ask questions to you and try to get an interactive session back. I'll just go forward, and then at the end of it, I will ask you questions, or you can ask me questions. Okay. So Spider-Man is one of the earliest applications of nanotechnology, and the learning is from the Spider-Man. What does he do? He walks on the walls. How does he do that? So that is learning from nature. I'll come to that. This is basically inspired by the gecko, the lizard. Then you have this nanotechnology Hulk. Then you have this Men in Black, where they make a statement. What is it with you humans and size anyways? Just because something is important doesn't mean that it can't be very, very small. So they also understood the importance that small is also very, very important. Okay. Now, all this is, of course, fiction in the movies, but they're not just kind of science fiction. They're all kind of reality. So first of all, it is not new. It's not something new. It has been there for a long time. But the thing, the terminology of nano was not used then. So the earliest example which people now understood is the TEM image of the nanowires, especially in the sword. Damascus steel. The steel which has got carbon nanotubes in that is actually responsible for the very strong, the strength of that material that they're able to do now because they're able to see those sizes. Till then, they used to only use the steel, hit it under a heating condition, say for to make it into, beat it into a knife and so on, but nothing beyond that. But now we realize that actually the internal structure of the material composed of this, the steel is composed of, actually gives that mechanical strength which can be attributed to the nanoparticles. Then you have this very fantastic cup, which is called a Zeigarnik cup. And here it is, when you see it, just like that, it looks green in color, but it shines differently. When it is illuminated from outside, it appears green, but when it's illuminated from inside, it appears red. It's simply because of the phenomenon of scattering, reflection, and diffraction, okay? So we are seeing so many things in nature. Have we really, stopped and seen what nature has taught us? Because there was a very old statement by a very famous scientist that he said, nature is the ultimate nanotechnologist. And the world is composed of atoms and molecules from which nature has built up inanimate and animate systems. Rock, sea, air, all these living things are systems whose working is defined entirely the nanoscale. So nanomaterials have been with us throughout our evolution and are common to our modern existence. It's only upon us to understand these phenomena, try to mimic them and use them in trying to make these new materials. So the last 30 to 40 years has got a lot of focus in this field of research. Why? Because first of all, the major interest everybody got interested is, it's a highly interdisciplinary field. As I already told you, you need physicists, chemists, biologists, engineers, computational chemists, all of them have to participate. Unless everybody participates, it is not possible to make any dent in this area of research. So why sudden focus in this area? Because first, tools are available. You are actually able to see the nano-sized particles. So that is one major advantage. Secondly, global competition. Global competition, why do I say that? Because maybe for about 50, 60 years back, we were all took it lazy, you know. People in the US or people in your Western countries or Japan, they will take the trouble of discovering materials, we can use it, no issue. So, but now we know and we have understood that unless we had developed our own materials which are suitable to our kind of environment in our country, it is not going to be useful because nobody is going to give you anything free of cost. You have to pay for it. And that paying is actually very, very expensive. Expensive not in terms of money, but they can put blocks, roadblocks. They may not give you the best. They give you the second best or the third best or something which is not useful to them. So that actually has pushed us, even India and Indian scientists, to move forward this kind of a global competition, which actually is pushing us and a lot of researchers to work in this area of science and technology. And of course, multi-billion investment worldwide, all over the world, including India. There is a lot of R&D funding in this research area, and that also is kind of an attraction. Last but not the least, the real useful products are already known. Okay, now everybody will not believe. If you tell somebody that I'm working on nanomaterials, nobody will believe you. They think, oh, you're just wasting money. Okay, people will believe you only if the real useful products are there in the market, and you can tell them that, listen, man, you have the components of this particular device are nano-sized. And because of the nano-size, you've got these kind of advantages, these kind in terms of economy, in terms of cost, in terms of the performance, simply because the size, you're getting all these advantages. Unless you show them the real useful products, nobody's going to believe you. And so now we know that there are a lot of useful products in the market, which actually are pushing this research in this area as well. And finally, of course, favorable response to global climate change. Yes, we expect that trying to make nanomaterials would actually make it more greener and reduce the global warming and so on. It is correct to a certain extent, but there is a school of thought which actually counters this belief. They say that by making nanomaterials, actually you are exposing humans to very toxic materials, because nanomaterials are very fine sized particles. They would tend to enter the nose or the lungs or the mouth or through the skin, and they would be cancerous and they would be harmful to our body. So working in this area of nanoscience and technology is actually not good for mankind. Okay, there is that school of thought. So to actually move forward, since we know that these sized materials are actually performing better than the other sized materials, to actually make us move forward, you have to try to be intelligent and try to take the necessary precautions to avoid these kind of accidents and do it in a way that would help the environment and not deteriorate. Okay. The second, of course, is the industry impact of nanotechnology. Now, all this is possible only if the industry is interested. You can make beautiful nanomaterials in the laboratory, in your lab, in your institute, in your college, show a very good microscopic picture, but industry would be interested only if it is economically feasible. What do you mean by economically feasible? It has to be cost effective. So when you are talking about nanotechnology and its what would be the impact on the industry, you are going to show the new properties or the enhanced properties. You can even think about incremental improvements in the products. And of course, you can show the impact it has on a lot of applications like drug delivery and all this. Finally, you have to show that it is cost effective as well. That is, you're paying a price, but you're getting the improved performance. Of course, there are a lot of big names in nanoscience. One of them is Smalley, then you have Eric Drexler. They have made very big names in their own fields, but the two of them, they don't agree. They are good friends, but their scientific theories, they still don't agree. Okay, so some of them say that it's only a pop culture, it'll just be like a movie, you know, it just fills off. But then there are others who say that no, it is possible. You can actually think of making robots and things like that, where you see in science fiction. And as we are seeing, all things are happening. So it's nothing just to have a belief. You're able to see most of the things. Lot of instrumentation, lot of biomedical devices, which are actually based on nanoscience and technology, where you can actually see the particles or those small devices going into the body and doing things which you could never even dream of. Then all this is possible simply first and foremost, the most important invention, of course, is the microscope, the electron microscope, because of which you are able to see the individual particles, and thereby you are able to actually put them in the right places using the AFM and things like that. So these kind of instrumentation has helped us to go a long way. You can actually try to play with these materials, see the materials, place the materials at where you want to actually use it. And that's how here you can see actually nano-sized iron atoms, they are placed one by one and you can arrange the nanoparticles. So it is possible, all this is possible, and that is why you are trying to move forward. Now, coming to, as I already told you, nature has been the ultimate nanotechnologist. Okay, just by looking at nature and learning from nature, you can think of multiple or millions of devices and instruments or instrument. You can think of materials you can make in just trying to see nature and trying to mimic it. I'll just give you maybe about three examples, but it is not the end. There are many more. Okay, first of course is the lotus leaf effect. Dr. Sudeshna remembers this lotus leaf effect in my earlier talk as well. The lotus leaf effect. What is a lotus leaf effect? It is basically, you know that when you water droplets fall on a lotus leaf, they just roll down. Okay. When we were in school, we were told that the lotus leaf has got a waxy surface, and because of which the water forms kinds of beads and it rolls down. But now we are able to actually hold the leaf under the microscope. And what we realize, the leaf is not a plain sheet of paper. It has got very fine hairs. This is the SEM image of the lotus leaf. And you can see fine hair-like follicles on the leaf. And the distance between these follicles actually makes the water droplet on the leaf either hydrophobic or hydrophilic. And it is so appropriate that you get a super hydrophobic surface. About the contact angle is about greater than 150. So because of this, the water, when it falls on the leaf, it becomes spherical in shape. And then because of the spherical shape, it rolls down. The beauty is, it's not just the water rolling down the leaf. While rolling down, it takes the dust particles along with it. So it's basically a super hydrophobic self-cleaning surface of the lotus leaf, which is what nature offers you with the lotus. Now, going to where can we use this? Do you know where it's being used? Have you seen any places where this technology is being used? Simple things you can talk about is tabletops and all that, where they don't allow you to get dirty. But beyond that, actually, these kind of super hydrophobic surfaces are used as coatings on the high-rise building window panes. So what happens when you have, say, a 15 or 20-story building and you have the windows, the outside of the windows gets dirty? What happens is in the morning, because of the mist, the water droplets condense on the glass window panes. And when the sun comes out, these water droplets condense, form dew, and the dew rolls down. So while rolling down, the dew takes the dust along with it. So you have self-cleaning super hydrophobic surfaces, which actually keeps the windows clean in the high-rise buildings. That is one example. And there are many more applications. I'll just give you one. But you can think of so many examples for this kind of a material. So you can actually make a material where you have a surface and you have follicles. The distance between the follicles, you try to arrange them in of the order of nanometers and see what happens. Next is the gecko effect, which I already mentioned to you. The Spider-Man effect, whatever you call it, is a gecko. Gecko is basically belongs to the lizard family. I think you can see here, I've shown here the human foot. Okay, it is plain, the surface is plain. Whereas a lizard foot is something like this, which I've shown the background, the brown. So basically the lizard foot is having small hair kind of a thing on its feet. And the end of each hair or tubule, there is a cup. I think you must have seen those which you use them for holding the hangers or on the cupboards. You can have the stickers. You have, because of suction, those things hold on the very smooth surfaces. It's basically the same thing, but in a nanoscale. So you have millions of such tubes with the cup at the end, which actually gives it the sticking power. So it can actually bear the weight of the animal, and the animal is able to walk on the walls. But we humans cannot do that. But the most interesting part of it is, yes, it has got a sticking power. But if the surface is dirty, the lizard falls down. Okay, so it needs to be, it is basically a self-cleaning and sticking both ways. Now, where do you think you can use this? This sticking power is not because of any glue. Okay, you know, sellotape and these kind of sticking tapes where you have a plastic sheet and then a small coating of an adhesive, which actually gives a sticking power. But this sticking is without any additional adhesive. So people are talking of trying to use this technology in trying to make adhesive tapes that stick without adhesive. Where could you use them? Actually, you could use them in the internal body when you do surgery, internal wounds or internal cuts. When you want to heal them, you can actually use this adhesive tapes made of biodegradable polymers. Over a period of time, you don't have any gum, which is not good for the body. And then over a period of time, the biodegradable polymer dissolves off. And then by the time the wound also heals. So it's already being worked out. And this work is being done it's already there. This product's already there in the market. The next one, of course, is the peacock feathers. Peacock feathers have got multiple colors, beautiful colors. What do you think? Are these colors fixed or do they change with time? I can't get expect answers from you all because I'm not able to listen to you. But yes, these colors are not fixed. They keep changing depending on how you look at it. Okay. So basically the title is viewing at different angles. The different colors are because of viewing at different angles. Basically, you have very fine crystals arranged on the leaf of the on the, arranged on the feathers of the peacock, and when you view at it at different angles, you get the different colors. Now, where do you think you could use this technology, viewing at different angles? Okay, one of the most cosmetic thing which you can use of is you can use these kind of materials or nanoparticles in the paint industry. You can actually have car paints made of this kind of crystals. When you look at the car from one side, it looks one color, from another side, another color. Of course, it's a costly affair, but people are ready to pay, so why not? Now, I gave you the examples in nature. Now, how is it getting translated into nanotech? Okay, the first example was, of course, the peacock feather or the butterfly feather, whatever it is. This principle is what is called as the iridescence. Okay, the colors change depending on the angle at which you look at the surface. So different thicknesses like with bubbles can create iridescence. Nano and micro features, as in the blue dwarf butterfly, also called iridescence. What does iridescence do in nature? Of course, it has got a different purpose. This is for attracting the mates and camouflage and so on. But where can we use this? Actually, this is how the arrangement is. The arrangement of the crystals, and this is a microscopic image of the butterfly wings. And you can actually use this technology in cryptocurrency, okay? In security ink, credit cards. And very recently, Qualcomm, this is not very recent, it's already 3 years old, 4 years old. Qualcomm has this e-screen. You have this problem, especially when you're looking at your mobile in the sun, under the sun. The screen becomes blurred or hazy. You're not able to see the text properly. So what they do is, and under those conditions, the iridescence of the blue dwarf butterfly, that thing is used up and the screen gets automatically brighter in the sunlight. Okay, this is the phenomenon which is being already adopted in mobile phones and computer screens. Then you have this lotus effect, which is there in the paint. Now, Lotusan is a paint which is being sold by Nerolac and many others, which actually has a self-cleaning features. So it cleans and along with the rolling of the water. And you get different colors. As you can have it in fabrics also. Nanotech fabrics repels liquids and stains, also mimicking the lotus effect. Then here I've put down a few examples, okay, where the basis is in nanotechnology, but you are having a lot of products already in the market. This, of course, the birds thing has been there for quite a long time now, and you have the Velcro. Okay, the shark skin, if you see the nanostructure of the shark skin, the scales are arranged in such a way that the shark can swim very fast, even against the current. So actually, what man is doing is trying to mimic this and try to make swimsuits such that the fabric is in such a way, trying to mimic this arrangement so that he experiences very minimum resistance when he's swimming. You have the termite dens, and termite dens is one of the best examples for cool buildings, and that's being now replicated or trying to be included in high-rise buildings. So these are just a few examples. There are many more. I've just listed them here. By just putting it here, actually this opens up so many areas of research you can think about, depending on you're a biologist or a chemist or a physicist, whatever it may be. You can talk about nerve conduction, you can talk about, because the beauty of this science is it doesn't tell you if it is a chemical material or it's a biological material. For it, a DNA or a titanium dioxide nanoparticle, both are the same. Because finally, what is it? It's the interaction that is important. So you can think of actually attaching a DNA particle or DNA molecule with a TiO2 nanoparticle, or you can think about DNA attaching to a gold nanoparticle, so on. So a lot of biology and chemistry can come together, and you can actually think of so many new materials which are possible. It all depends on, the limit is your imagination. You can think of what can you attach with what and do what is the question. So your polymers, structural materials, electrical. And the inspiration is from, you can read here, the photonic crystals, adhesives, high tensile strength fibers, artificial intelligence computing. Human brain is the best example of artificial intelligence computing. Okay, so you are trying to mimic the human brain and going in for AI. And applications of nanotechnology are just innumerable, honestly innumerable. So depending upon your field of research, you can actually choose and make. But of course, you need the You can't say that you're a physicist, you don't understand biology. You need to learn or call a physicist and join along with them and then try to come out with products, which will be, you do the synthesis, they do the characterization, then you do the applications in biology. So nanotechnology, nanobiotechnology, these are all upcoming areas of research, actually, which can be kind of tapped for a lot of future R&D, especially schools and colleges. You don't need very high-tech equipment for that. You can do it in a small chemistry lab. But of course, for the characterization, you can use simple techniques like UV visible absorption or XRD. But if you really want to see the materials under the microscope, you need to go in front of the electron microscope. And I think now electron microscopes are very easily available in most of the universities and colleges. These are some of the products which are already in the market. I already told you about the sunscreen. The earlier ones used to be white in color. Now you have transparent sunscreens. Then, and that's only because of the absorption difference you have here. Then you have this very, very important industry where nanotechnology has made a very big dent is in the plastic bottle. Now, plastic bottles are being used so commonly, especially for water and for fruit drinks. Especially when you're trying to store fruit drinks in your plastic bottles, the disadvantage is over a period of time, because of oxygen entering the bottle, the drink or the juice becomes rancid and becomes toxic. So how do you avoid that? They have actually found out a way, just by adding very small percentage of nanoparticles, you can actually reduce this oxygen transmission rate to such an extent that you can increase the life of the product. That is, the drinks and all can be stored for a much longer time. And that has actually proven to be very, very advantageous or very, very economically very attractive to the food and beverage industry. Then you have all these products. You have fabrics, which are hydrophobic, crease-proof fabrics. Then, of course, you have all the sporting goods where the weight of those, like rackets and baseballs and all of the weight has been reduced so that because of the introduction of, say, maybe carbon nanotubes and so on, or even, say, alumina nanotubes, it's like that. So they're already there in the market. Then you have this memory devices, which I think our generation has seen how the size of the CDs and thing have reduced. And now you have pen drives with gigabytes and terabytes and things like that, and just, say, 1 centimeter by 1 centimeter kind of thing. So basically, you have come down, reduce the size of the devices by actually playing with the nanomagnetic materials. Then you have a lot of things which are already there in the domestic use. Like you have these kind of commodes. What is nanotechnology being used there? They are in Japan, actually, most of these ceramic pottery is being incorporated with gold nanoparticles. So gold acts as a catalyst, and if there is a foul smell, amine kind of foul smell, it converts them into nitrates and reduces the foul smell. So these are already there even in the domestic market. Okay. Then, of course, all these are already known. This nano silver being used in the refrigerator, washing machine, you all know very well now. What is the nano silver doing there? It's because of the antibacterial property and so on. So the nanoproducts are already there in the market. So this has actually given a big boost to this research, because it's not just science fiction. You can actually work and make a dent in that. So these are some more products which are already there in the market. And this is what I talked about, the magnetic storage devices, which I already told you. That means they're converting into nitrates. Then you have the catalyst, the catalytic converter, especially in the vehicles, where it converts the carbon monoxide, that completely carbon dioxide into carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide to carbon dioxide, and reduces pollution. So these are all catalytic materials. And because they're nanosized, they're very easy to be put into the existing kind of sieves or kind of mesh-like structure. And they're much more efficient than micron-sized particles. First of all, you need much lesser quantity of the material, and secondly, they're much more effective. Then you have different structures in trying to increase the surface area, which is actually, when you talk about nanomaterials, there are only two phenomena. One is the larger surface area, and the other one is the particle size. So these two are the only two parameters which actually control all the properties. So you can make very fine, small particles, you can increase the surface area, and try to come out with better performing materials. Then in biology, I already told you about DNA gold or DNA TiO2. where you can think of attaching all kinds of biological proteins and so many other things, lipids and proteins, etc., to magnetic nanoparticles or to gold nanoparticles or to TiO2, and think of use them as markers. And these are already there in the biomedical industry. So this is the iron oxide nanoparticles, which we use as for magnetic targeting and for hypothermia, biological applications, biomedical research. The next three or four slides are just actually, they are possibilities. They have not been realized, but it is possible. We know that ceramic is supposed to be very hard material, very brittle. But by making the ceramic composite of nano-sized ceramic particles, you can introduce flexibility. So you can think of what is called as a ceramic cloth. So you have the advantage of thermal resistance as well as flexibility. Both are possible. So this is basically a ceramic cloth or machinable ceramic. Then you have temperature sensitive glass, where with the temperature, the color changes. Okay. So this would be some kind of a sensor to detect any other phenomena. Then you have flavor changing additives. These are already there in the market. I don't know if you have come across them, but they are like additives in the food, which actually increases the shelf life. It actually introduces flavors, required flavors. Now, somebody doesn't eat non-veg, is a vegetarian, and he wants to eat food which tastes like non-vegetarian food. So you can actually put in capsules or kind of micellar kind of structures. And when you eat, you bite into them, it releases that flavor. So basically, it's nano and nanospheres encapsulated. They actually burst with the new flavors. So you can actually eat the food that you want without actually eating that. So this is already there in the food industry, and you are getting much fluffier ice cream and much softer cakes, all because of nanotechnological interventions. Then you have this I already told you about the Velcro, but this Velcro is multifunctional. You can actually make and break circuit kind of a thing. So it's a conductive hook and loop Velcro. So it does both job. It's like a switch as well as it's sticking. This is one of the inventions NASA has been working on. And in this, to a very large extent of the materials used in this are nanomaterials. So what actually has happened is the payload has been reduced to a large extent, and that actually has made it very, very fuel efficient. This is kind of a science fiction presently, but there is no harm in actually dreaming about it, because this is a car. And in this, most of the sensors and all nanomaterials. Okay, but the additional feature is, you must have seen these days in the cars when you're driving, you can actually charge your mobiles or small devices, where actually the kinetic energy is getting converted to potential energy and charging your batteries. Now, if you extend that a little further, if you can actually have panels of batteries or on this car, as the car is moving at whatever speed, as it's moving, it converts all the kinetic energy into potential energy and stores the batteries. And later, the same battery is used to run the car. So basically, you don't need any fuel. Okay, it's interchangeable. This is still a science fiction, but quite a bit of it is proving that it is possible to come out with this concept. So that comes to the end of my presentation. And of course, the final word is, you have to have new ideas. And these new ideas will lead to new technologies, and new technologies will demand new materials. When you talk of new materials, the material scientists have to come into play. Thank you very much for your attention. And if there are any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer. These are some of my colleagues, Dr. Pratyay, Dr. Rana, Ramanuj Narayan. We are a small team in the nanomaterials group. These are the students and other helpers. I will stop sharing, okay?
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much, madam, for a thought-provoking talk. Very, very interesting talk with a lot of interesting examples. I'd have like to ask a few small questions, which may be very trivial. That you have shown one in super cooling building.
Yeah.
In one slide. So how it is making the building like super cooling?
It's kind of a ventilation, cross ventilation. The architects are designing it, the buildings, in such a way the temperatures come down by at least 5 to 6 degrees. So that makes that makes the air conditioning more efficient. And the temperatures are much lower than when you don't have those kind of architectures. It is now, these are all green buildings. Architects are coming out with green buildings. So green buildings, the architect, they're actually trying to mimic those structures.
Okay.
It's already there. It's I think Reliance has come up with kind of a green building somewhere here in Hyderabad also.
Okay, ma'am. And another that you have shown that some camouflage by the peacock feather
at camouflage, looking at angles. Yeah, viewing at different angles.
So will you please explain?
They are basically crystals. They are single crystals. Okay. Yes. And they are arranged along the feathers. Okay. Hmm. When you look at it from one angle, it looks, depending on the diffraction of light, it gives a different color. The colors are not because of the colors of, there's no dye in that peacock feather. It is just the light which is falling on the peacock and getting scattered or reflected, which gives a different color. So hence the color keeps changing every time. It is not a fixed blue or a pink color. It's not camouflage. It is iridescence, it's called as.
Okay. So
you see, like, you see when you have a prism, okay? You have a prism, you enter white light. On the other side, you get all the colors. Same colors. Okay? So suppose you focus yourself on one of the windows. You will see only pink color in another window. So it's basically different angles of refraction are giving you the different colors. And that is what is happening in a peacock feather.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't actually have to put in a dye. Color is not required. It is just the light, the visible light, which is going through those crystals and giving that color.
So with extrapolation of these theory, can this invisible cloth can be made, right?
Yeah, it is there. They're talking about magnetic materials wherein you talk about the especially for army people, they're talking about the army cannot detect you, kind of. Yeah, it is there. They're trying to make, you can actually make those materials. So basically, the visible light should not reflect so that you don't get the information. The enemy should not get the information from you.
So that is amazing.
Exactly. That's already there. That is one of the military applications.
Yes,
It's going on, yeah.
Okay. And another last point from my last question from my side, then some other questions are there that I'll read. That ma'am, in your brief CV, I have seen that you have talked about surface engineering to oxide particles, right?
Yes.
So in this surface coating agent, is graphene is already used for coating oxides. So I just wondering what kind of bond it is making with the oxide core.
Actually, when you make oxide nanoparticles,
yes.
Can you can hear me, right?
Yes.
Oxide nanoparticles, depending on how you synthesize, you can have a surface which is with OH molecules, OH entities, or you can synthesize them with an amine entity. You can dope it, dopamine you can attach, depending on what is the next material you want to attach. Now, what we did is for a biological application, it has to be water soluble. Mm-hmm. Especially in biology, you cannot think of using propane or any of these solvents, C2H alcohol or anything. You have to use, it has to be water soluble.
So
nanoparticles water soluble, we need to actually surface functionalize it in such a way that it disperses very well in water. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then surface functionalize it maybe with an amine or any other molecule. Maybe people are talking about PEG, polyethylene glycol, or if you want a surface functionality with sulfur.
Mm-hmm.
Biology, a lot of biological molecules have got sulfur or nitrogen. So you can think of any material, any solvent or organic molecule, you can put it on the surface. And that will help you to anchor the next molecule. Now, suppose you want to attach a sensor material.
Mm-hmm.
And say maybe gold nanoparticle. Gold is very commonly used. So we took a magnetic nanoparticle, maybe iron oxide.
Mm-hmm.
And on the iron oxide, we attached amine.
Mm-hmm.
And the binding from NH2 to the protein or to the dye is possible. Of course, it's a stepwise process. Finally, you should be sure on what is the final material you are looking for. So you have to go step by step.
Yeah, just let me put the question like this. If this material is, suppose, ammonium perchlorate, not nano-sized, like normal size, micron size, or like 1 micron, 2 micron kind of. And if we are just making the coating with graphene, so my question is of twofold. Number one is whether the interface XPS will able to see the bond.
Yes, you can. The carbon binding in graphene will be different than the carbon binding to ammonium perchlorate. I'll give you an example with this, because let's assume not graphene. I have done it on C3N4, GC3N4. It's a similar kind of a structure which has got a nitrogen in that. And we make a composite with an oxide, maybe zinc oxide or tin dioxide or anything. There we see that zinc gets bound to the nitrogen. We see an extra peak in the XPS. Apart from the carbon binding to nitrogen, we see a zinc binding to nitrogen.
So that means zinc oxide was a coating, you mean to say?
It's a composite. You made a composite of zinc oxide and GC3N4.
Okay, I'm talking about just simpler surface coating.
Even if it's surface coating also, no issue. You can still see. Because 100% it's not going to coat.
Of course not. Yeah, yes. But
you will see. So you will see some places open up also. So you can hit the surface.
Okay. So
because in XPS, you have some kind of escape depth. You can get the information right up to, say, 20 nanometers or 30 nanometers. You can get it.
But will it be able, we can understand what kind of bonding. It's a covalent bond, it's ionic bond, or,
if there is a literature, to that, because the position of the binding energy position can tell you what type of bond it is. C double bond, O, or...
Okay. I understand.
This is a binding backwards.
Okay.
If it's SP3, SP2 kind of a binding, or is it covalent or ionic? So those are already known.
Okay.
So you have to do IR and XPS, both.
Okay. And to see whether the coating or surface engineering, whatever we can see, it's durable. I think this knife test.
Yeah, those things. Yeah.
Paper abrasion test.
Abrasion test. That is, yeah. That you is do a lot of sonication and see that gets shattered sometimes.
Yeah.
Very high sonication also separates some of the coating very often. Okay.
So these are all the tests, that nice scratching, pencil scratching, sandpaper.
Exactly. Those are all those are all mechanical engineering.
And TEM will tell us something about the shell
if you can focus what is the size of the particle, and you should be able to focus at the interface. Because when you have particle, you should be able to focus at the interface, then only you can see the difference, contrast.
No, for the graphene, like graphene coating, will it be able?
Graphene coating is no issue, but if the size of the particle is very big, it's going to be opaque.
Okay, size of the particle is around, suppose, 6 micron. Or
no,
10.
Micron, it will not even hold there, because it will be like a black ball. Transmission, the beam has to go through.
Okay. So
if you can go to the edge, if there's some transparency, in the center part, it's not going to be. At the edge, if you're lucky to get some kind of transparency, you can see.
Or ACM will tell something about...
ACM can tell you a little bit. That's only surface.
Otherwise, XPS is the
IR, best. IR with XPS. IR can tell you the bonds.
FTIR.
You have to go together. Yeah, FTIR.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much. Now, let me go through the other questions. Or Jyoti, madam, you can also read the questions.
Ji, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, there is a question. Can nanomaterial surface reflect electromagnetic waves?
Yes, I already told them just now. Yes, you can. It interacts with electric. Finally, what you are doing is basic kind of a plasmon.
Yeah.
Whatever the transparency which you talk about, which I said in the beginning, zinc oxide nanoparticles or the alumina particles, it is an interaction of the material with the electromagnetic radiation. Okay. Yes. So when you say electromagnetic radiation, if it is visible light, you see it as a transparent, translucent. But if it is, say, any other electromagnetic radiation, maybe X-rays or gamma rays or something, it is going to interact in its own way.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
the universality is there. Nothing changes. Only thing, it depends on which area of the spectrum you are interested in.
Yes, ma'am. The next one is, why alumina, transparent ceramic? In transparent ceramic, why alumina mostly is translucent?
Yeah, because of the scattering.
Okay.
The particles are polycrystalline, so the surface of the particles are defective.
Okay.
In a single crystal, it's very well arranged, so there's no scattering taking place. It's transparent.
Okay.
If it is because of that, it's the color.
Yeah.
You can see that even normally sugar crystals, you powder the sugar, it becomes white. When the crystals are there, it's nice and transparent.
Yeah.
Why? Simple. The same reason.
Yeah. The next question is, ma'am, what further study can be done on chromium?
No, because of the scattering, madam. You are telling that
scattering. The light is scattered, no? So it becomes white in color. Sugar or any glass for the back, glass, you powder it.
Huh.
If it is a single, it's a nice one piece, it's transparent. You powder it, it becomes white. Because of scattering.
The scattering decreases.
Scattering of light, which is making it white in color.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Then, ma'am, what further study can be done on chromium doped alumina transparent ceramic?
What do you mean by further? I didn't understand. For what? What is the application you're looking for?
Yeah. Transparent ceramic question is about for transparent ceramic alumina doped. Further study can be done.
You can get different colors, no?
Okay.
Chromium actually gives you colors. Instead of chromium, you put some other material, you get colors. If you're talking about glasses.
I think this is alumina, this is ruby, right? Artificial ruby.
Yes. Pink in color, alumina.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is the changing colors according to the surroundings by cameleon, can it be understood by nanotechnology?
Yes, it is. That's what I said. It is that they keep changing the colors. We think that they're changing colors. Actually, it's not. They're hiding. They're trying to hide.
There is one question from my student, a UG BSc first year student, Amitesh Verma. Ma'am, can we control nanoparticles with any controller or any sensor or wire or mine?
I didn't understand the question, honestly.
I don't.
Can we control?
Can we control nanoparticles with any controller or any sensor or by our mind? Actually, you have given examples of Hulk and Spider-Man and so on. So that
yeah,
is
so you can make those. You can make those materials, no?
Okay.
You can make it in the laboratory.
Okay.
They're all polymers. They could be inorganic materials. It's all up to you. You can make it like a cube. You can make it like a sphere. You can make it like a tube, and see if you can arrange them all like how the gecko is doing it. You can do it.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. And the last question is, how can we use nanotechnology to tackle climate change?
Yes. To?
Tackle climate change.
Tackle climate change. That's what I told you. I said, if you can adopt all these things, because nanomaterial synthesis by itself doesn't need very... Nature is doing it at room temperature. You know corals. You know the corals? They have beautiful structures. How do they form those structures? They are doing it in water, seawater, room temperature, and by secreting calcium carbonate. But those structures are so hard. They don't need furnace or they don't need an instrument to make that kind of materials. So if nature can do it at room temperature, so there is some science behind. If you can understand how that creature is making those nanomaterials, you can actually make them in the lab. So that is what is a very interesting, branch of nanotechnology, bio-inspired synthesis or biomimicking. So people are trying to make all these materials which you normally use in the furnace using, but you can make it at room temperature. It's possible. So if you can all, of course, at the moment, it is not cost effective. So if you can do it in larger scales and becomes cost effective, then yes, you can. It is going to. One simple example where, our government also has to put in a little bit of effort. Canada, government of Canada is actually coming out with what are called as green cement. They don't use the cement because cement is one of the most polluting material which releases carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. So what the theory, and in all over the world, maximum amount of cement is used not in building new structures, in repairing. Because the quality is so bad, you end up spending more money, more cement, and polluting the environment more. But if you can really think of using geopolymers, Canada is doing it in a big way, but investment is going to be high in the beginning, but the results will come maybe at 10, 20 years later on. But the problem here is, who is going to invest that money? That is the biggest question mark. If somebody is there to invest the money, then anybody is ready to take up that kind of research. And especially talking about cement and all, you have to manufacture them in tons. 1 gram and 2 grams is not sufficient.
Yes,
so
yes.
That is still a challenge. If all that is possible, yes, you can.
Yes.
And can we take one more question?
Already madam has told that regarding the lotus leaf, how they clean, right? So yeah. I think that, yeah, already dust cleaning, self-cleaning, she has explained. Ma'am, just one thing that this chameleon and that they are changing the color, this is somehow related to this
iridescence. Actually, you can give it a Google search and read that. You'll find exactly the phenomenon what it is.
Okay.
It's all there in the literature.
Okay. Yeah.
Because I think it's not, you're not getting impressed with that thing till you read it. How actually the colors change with viewing at different angles.
Yes, yes, yes. And another point, ma'am, I saw that you are a course coordinator of advanced functional material courses. So is there any certification course?
No. Actually, this is for our PhD students because we give our own degrees now. ACSR is a university. So we have our own PhD students. So it's a course curriculum for them. All across CSIR.
No, I'm asking that is there any provision where our university students or teachers can do a certification program or course on advanced materials and they can get the certificate for like 7 days, 14 days?
They are trying to get it from CSIR, but as of now, no. Actually, there are some things in DST, the TAIR program and things like that, where you can come and work for say 3 months in a year and you get a sponsorship from DST.
No. I'm not talking about the sponsorship. I'm talking.
No, but it gives you a research opportunity to work in IICT or anywhere like that. But certification course, there's nothing. They do have sometimes, but it is not a regular basis. It's not a regular. Sometimes it comes up. You can have a look at the website when it comes up, something like that. Let you know if there is something.
Yeah. Because in the case, our student can get if they 3 days, 4 days.
I understand.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Yes, so I think there are no more questions, Dr. Jyoti.
Yeah, ma'am.
In this case, let us congratulate madam and convey her big thanks from us. And now I'd like to request Jyoti ma'am to please provide the vote of thanks.
Thank you so much, Sudeshna ma'am. Respected Manorama ma'am, our most valued invited guest, Dr. Neetu Paliwal, Dean Faculty of Science, Dr. Pragya Srivastava, Head of the Department, all my dear faculty members, students and dear panelists, it's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks to on this occasion. I, Jyoti Rawat, on behalf of Rabindranath Tagore University and the entire Faculty of Science, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to honorable speaker for gracing your wonderful lecture and sharing knowledge with us, your findings and opinions in this webinar, ma'am. A very big thanks to you, ma'am, especially sharing for such an interesting examples of nanotechnology, and I think it is a joint step ahead to start some more collaborative research. We are looking forward to you, ma'am, in future also with some more good and new ideas adding to our work. And also, I must mention our deep sense of appreciation to Dr. Nitin Vats, sir, Director IQAC, who has motivated us to organize this series of webinar. I also wish to express my gratitude to Dr. Sangeeta Johri ma'am, coordinator IQAC, for providing encouragement on this webinar. I may like to express our sincere thanks, especially to Dr. Sudeshna Ray ma'am, to conduct this series of webinar. And this is the last session of this series. So thank you to all. Thanks to everyone who have joined us directly or indirectly in this session, in this complete series of sessions. So thanks to all, thanks everyone for joining us. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
One more request to you, ma'am. Please take time for us and also visit our campus.
Yes, we'd like to invite in person, rather webinar.
Sure. I'll come.
Pandemic. Yes. Because it's always a lovely experience and it becomes like... to extend the session more and more, so that
all right, okay, my pleasure.
It's amazing.
Once the corona thing goes off, I think it should be possible to travel.
Yes, because we all like get so much enthusiasm to know what is happening when you are talking about super cooling, Spider-Man, and
we have never listened about that. It is very interesting, actually. One of my students was also asking that, can we control nanotechnology by mind?
No, people are talking of artificial intelligence, so it should be possible, I suppose.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, like, Madam's talk is always like extremely interesting. Like, in some lectures in our college and university, I used to bunk. But in some lectures, we wait for long time. So, Madam's lecture.
Thank you so much.
We are also waiting for you, ma'am. Please do come in future for
my pleasure. I will.
Thank you very much.
So thank you. I will disconnect. Okay.
Yeah. I'd like to conclude the session. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye bye.